St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. We're at the corner of Columbia and Wittenberg, across from Springfield Regional Medical Center. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. We have Wednesday night service in the chapel at 6:30 with communion every Wednesday. We celebrate communion the first and third Sundays of the month. September 4th, Labor Day weekend, will be our last service at the drive-in, and it is the pet blessing. So bring your pets, cats, dogs, rabbits, birds, whatever. Ride your horse in if you want. So please enjoy the service. Thank you. Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Sunday, August 21st, 2016. Today is the 14th Sunday after Pentecost.
Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is Sunday, August the 21st, 2016. The 14th Sunday after Pentecost. We're at the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. We invite you to come worship every Sunday. This song was written by Isaac Watts, the father of English hymnology. He started writing when he was 18 years old, wrote a hymn every week. This is "We're Marching to Zion," or "Come We That Love the Lord." And we know that we love the Lord and we're going to receive the Lord, body and blood, Jesus Christ today.
Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
All your sins and heals all your diseases.
fire and darkness and gloom, and a tempest and the sound of a trumpet, and a voice whose words made the hearers bathe, yet not another word be spoken to them. For they could not endure the order that was given. If even an animal touches the mountain, it shall be stoned to death. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse the one who is speaking, for if they did not escape when they refused the one who warned them on earth, how much less will we escape if we reject the one who warns from heaven? At that time, his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised. Yet once more, I shall shake not only the earth, but also the heaven. This phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of what is shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. I hear, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us give thanks, by which we offer to God an acceptable worship with reverence and awe. For indeed our God is a consuming fire. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Rippon's selection of hymns. John Rippon pastors Carter's Lane Baptist Church. So this is a Baptist hymn in London. It was written in 1787 by John Rippon, a Baptist minister. His church was Carter's Lane Pulpit. He educated at Baptist College in Bristol, England. Baptist hymn, now from a foundation.
Just to never go to the chancel area again. But when I was living on my
And so I went with her into the church in order to prepare the elements for the Lord's Supper, which we would be celebrating on the next day. And I watched as Grandma filled the individual wine glasses and how she put the wafers in the proper vessel, and I thought that would be it, that she would leave then, and on Sunday morning the pastor would come in and pick those up and go place them on the altar for that, because that was his area. But instead, much to my horror and terror, my grandmother picked up the vessels and walked out the sacristy and up the steps and into the chancel and placed them on the altar, and I thought for sure she was going to be zapped. But of course, nothing happened. She placed the elements. We left, went back to the farm. Sunday we were there at church, had communion, and nothing happened. But that was the attitude that we grew up with, that you just didn't misbehave, especially in the worship area of the church. You didn't even go into it unless it was to worship. Or if you were going to clean something in the worship area, or because you had left something behind in the pew, and so you would go back and retrieve it. You wouldn't dare use the worship space as a shortcut to get to another part of the church building. That was just totally absurd. You just walk around. The worship space was for worship. So if it wasn't Sunday, if it wasn't midweek worship during Lent, if it wasn't Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, Ascension Day, or some other reason, a wedding, a funeral, whatever, the worship space was left alone. You could say that in our days of our youth, we had such an awe and reverence and respect for the worship area that we were almost like the Hebrew children we read about today in our second reading. How they were so scared at the base of Mount Sinai. How they were asking God to stop speaking because he was scaring them so with the thunder and fire and lightning that came with his voice speaking. They were terrified because he said even if an animal would touch that mountain, it would be or should be stoned to death. And then we hear Moses say, quote, "I am terrified and trembling," in the quote. That is the New Living Translation. NRSV, which you have an insert as, and the word's a little different. "But I am terrified and trembling." So maybe when we were growing up, we had a little bit too much Old Testament mentality towards the worship space and the chancel and the worship area. But one thing we do know is that that awe and respect and reverence that we had is definitely not present today in modern churches. Visit a modern church today, and more often than not, one of the first things you will immediately notice is a lack of typical traditional Christian symbols anywhere in the middle. You will not see paintings of biblical events or biblical stories or tapestries. You will not see stained glass windows in the worship space. You won't find a cross or a crucifix anywhere in the building. And more likely than not, you will not see an altar. But what you will do, or what you will see, is a stage up front or a raised platform. And on that platform will be large speakers and large amplifiers. There'll be guitar stands and music stands and microphone stands and a drum set and a keyboard. There'll also possibly be some type of lectern furniture on which the pastor will place their Bible, his or her Bible, while delivering the message. And it's always referred to as the message and not a sermon. If you go to such a service, another thing you will notice is where in our day we were taught to enter the service, the worship area in silence, sit in our pew and to pray or meditate until the prelude started and then the opening hymn. When we lived in Lexington for 2 years, as I mentioned to you before, so my dad could earn his doctorate degree at the University of Kentucky, the Lutheran church there had kneelers. And we were encouraged that when we came into church, we were to pull the kneeler down and kneel and pray until the prelude put the kneeler up, set our seat, and wait for the opening hymn to begin. We'll go to many of these modern day churches, and what you will see is the exact opposite of that. You will see people entering into the worship area laughing and talking, carrying cups of coffee and water bottles, and even if you're there at the right church at the right time, you may even see free popcorn and cokes in the narthex for you to pick up and take into the worship area. The worship area will be usually a large plain room. It'll have either temporary chairs or permanent chairs that more often than not will have cup holders in them, so you can put your latte or espresso or coffee, whatever. At the church our middle son Joel goes to in Indianapolis, every September they have what they call Faith and the Movies. So for every Sunday in September, they will show a clip from a movie or several clips, and interspersed with that comments by the pastor as to how that scene demonstrates something about the Christian faith or the Christian journey. And they have the technology and equipment so that they can insert the pastor so that it looks like he's actually in the scene of the movie, that he was there when the movie was made. And on those Sundays, as you enter, they encourage you to take popcorn and coke into the worship area with you. Now, as having grown up a traditional Lutheran, pastors I had and the congregation, the people in the congregation that I had, would have probably fainted at the idea of someone sitting in a pew eating popcorn and drinking Coca-Cola. Because we just don't see worship that way. We see worship as something we do for God, not something God does for us. We see it as coming in awe and reverence and respect to the Almighty God who sent to us His only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer and die on the cross for our salvation, and so we would never dare think about having popcorn and coke. Now, family night, we would do that. And I remember as a child, our church once a month having family night, we'd have a potluck, and then there'd either be a spooker, or there'd be a movie shown, or some other kind of activity, but worship, to us, that just is unthinkable. But it works. The church our son goes to, it has like five services, and every one of them is filled, plus the service on Saturday, which is filled, plus they have two satellite campuses, which also have worship that are filled, and then when it comes time for the sermon, they have a screen, and the pastor is shown on the screen. They watch it live via the screen, so they can see the preacher preaching as if he was there among them. And so it works, but it's a totally different experience from what we grew up with. In our second reading for today, in that 12th chapter of the letter to the Hebrews, the apostle does mention the joy we have in being part of the new Jerusalem, the new covenant, that we are part of Mount Zion and not part of Mount Sinai. He tells us that we have this joy in being in this new covenant as we come together to worship and be with God Himself and our Lord Jesus Christ. So this morning we want to focus on verses 22 and 24, through 24. Now again, I'm going to read to you from the New Living Translation. Now this isn't the Living Bible that was popular in the 80s. That was a paraphrase of the Bible. This is the New Living Translation, which actually is a pretty fair translation of the original Hebrew and Greek. I'm going to read it through the first time and make some comments about what is being written, and then I'm going to read it through again so you get the full gist and flow of it. So don't try to follow with your inserts since that's the NRSV. Listen as I speak. So the apostle says, no, you have come to Mount Sinai. Now what he means by that is, no, you're not part of Mount Sinai anymore. You're not part of the law. Salvation is not by works of the law. So you are not part of that. No, you have come to Mount Sinai, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to countless thousands of angels in a joyful gathering. You have come to the assembly of God's firstborn children. Now, why does he use that phrase? Well, Well, in Hebrew culture, the firstborn, especially a firstborn male, was the one who inherited the majority of everything from the father, from the family. And so in order to be one who inherits, you had to be firstborn. Well, as followers of Jesus Christ, we are all looked upon as being firstborn. No matter where we are actually in our family, whether the oldest or the youngest or the middle child, we are firstborn in the eyes of God and therefore inheritors of everything that Jesus Christ won for us through his death upon the cross. You have come to the assembly of God's firstborn children whose names are written in heaven. You have come to God himself, who is the judge over all things. You have come to Jesus, the one who mediates the new covenant between God and people. Word mediate being someone who works with two different sides to bring them together to work for a common purpose. We, because of sin, cannot reach God. Sin keeps us from God because God cannot be in the presence of sin. So Jesus, as a son of God, and through his sacrifice on the cross, is able to mediate them between us and God. To be able to be that one who brings us together so that God sees us as one who will inherit his eternal kingdom. So you have come to Jesus, the one who mediates the new covenant between God and the people, and in the sprinkled blood, which speaks of forgiveness, instead of crying out for vengeance like the blood of Abel. So, again, no, you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to countless thousands of angels in a joyful gathering. You have come to the assembly of God's firstborn children, whose names are written in heaven. You have come to God himself, who is the judge over all things. You have come to Jesus, the one who mediates the new covenant between God and the people, and to the sprinkled blood, which speaks of forgiveness, instead of crying out for vengeance like the blood of Abel. As we read this, the word translated as assembly is the Greek word from which we derive our English word church. It basically means those who've been called out by God, or those whom God has called to assemble. As the apostle writing to the Hebrews uses it in our text this morning, it means, quote, a festal gathering of the holy angels and the saints of God, living and dead. So this meaning illustrates that when we gather together to worship, we are gathered in a festive atmosphere because of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Every Sunday is a celebration of the resurrection. Of course, we have Easter, the highlight of the Christian year, every year after Lent and Holy Week is over. But every Sunday is to be a mini celebration of the resurrection. So every service is to be a festive service. And what we see is not only when we gather together to worship, are we here worshiping God, our Lord Jesus Christ. But remember last week in Hebrews 1, he talked about that great cloud of witnesses. All those who come before us in the faith, who cheer us on and tell us to keep running the race of life. Well, they are with us, plus all the angels are rejoicing. So as we worship in a festive mood, celebrating all that God has done for us through the sending of his Son, Jesus Christ. However, gathering in a festival mood does not mean that we do not gather with reverence, awe, and respect of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. We approach God not in fear and trepidation like the Hebrews, children in the verses above who were filled with fear and trepidation as they gathered at Mount Sinai, but we come with joy. And at the same time, we come with reverence as we realize how glorious is this place to worship God and Jesus Christ. In the early church, there were no church buildings. The early Christians had to meet in homes. They met in the catacombs of Rome and other places. They met in fields. They met in forests. They met in caves. They met wherever a group could gather together and have enough room to celebrate and worship God, to share in the Lord's Supper, to witness to those visitors who were with them, and together where they thought they would be safe and out of the way of being discovered for fear of persecution. But it didn't matter where they gathered. Home, field, forest, cave, catacombs, whatever, they always gathered in joy, knowing that Jesus is our mediator who enables us to continue that journey to Mount Zion, to continue that journey to the New Jerusalem, to continue that journey with joy, with reverence, with awe, and with respect. Church worship should not be sad and somber, for we have too much to be thankful for what Jesus did for us on our behalf. Unlike the pilgrimage to Sinai by the Hebrew children freed from bondage in Egypt, when we come to Jesus, he does not pronounce judgment on us, but makes us righteous before God because of his death upon the cross. Jesus washes our sin and heals that separation between us and God caused by the sin that we commit. We come with joyful and respectful hearts, knowing that we are in the presence of God himself, who is, as the apostle tells us, quote, judge over all things. So it is God's judgment which is final. There is no court of appeal. But for those of us who believe in Jesus Christ, we do not have to worry about that judgment. Because, as we are told by the apostle, we come before God as being righteous, sharing the righteousness of Jesus Christ. We do not fear God as judge, since we are washed in the blood of the Lamb, and his grace covers us. So God does not see our sin. He does not see a sinner in the hands of an angry God worthy of condemnation. But instead, he sees a child of his own, an heir to the kingdom, a brother or sister of our Lord Jesus Christ. We come in joy, respect, reverence, and honor, as we have a new covenant sealed not with the blood of animals, which has to be done over and over and over again, but sealed with the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who willingly poured out that blood on the mercy seat of the cross so that we might have salvation as a free gift. Salvation in Jesus Christ is a free gift, and it is not something we have to try to earn by doing good works, as is the case with the religions of the world. We come in joy, respect, reverence, and honor because the sprinkled blood of Jesus Christ speaks of forgiveness instead of crying out for vengeance like the blood of Abel. You remember the story of Cain and Abel, brothers of Adam, born to Adam and Eve. Cain was a farmer. Abel was a shepherd. They offered their gifts to God. Cain just gave God whatever vegetables he found. It didn't matter whether they were half rotten or even ripe, whatever. Whereas Abel brought the best of the firstborn lambs of his flock. God accepted Abel's sacrifice and rejected Cain. Cain becomes furious and murders his brother Abel. The blood of Abel soaks into the ground and cries up to God for vengeance. God comes to Cain and says, Cain, where is your brother Abel? And Cain responds with those infamous words, I don't know, am I my brother's keeper? And of course, then God confronts him with having murdered his son, his brother, and banishes him. Puts a mark on him so that no one will kill him. That is what the blood of Abel. The blood of Jesus Christ, on the other hand, does not cry out for vengeance, but calls up to the Heavenly Father asking for mercy and forgiveness. As we see demonstrated in Jesus' crucifixion that first Good Friday, the very first words out of his mouth are, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. And Jesus knew what was going to happen. He knew that he was going to be taken upon the sins of the whole world, and that was going to be agonizing and painful. He knew that in a few minutes he would be separated totally and completely from his Heavenly Father, as God had to turn his back so that Jesus' sacrifice could be the ultimate sacrifice and there would be no more need to sacrifice animals or grain or anything else in order to be right with God. And yet Jesus' first words are for our forgiveness, because even though we weren't there that first Good Friday, we were there in our sinfulness and we nailed Jesus to the cross just as the Romans who did the deed themselves. Yet Jesus asks that we be forgiven, for we know not what we are doing when we turn our back on him. However, we usually know what we're doing when we commit a sin, but we don't know what the consequences are going to be. We're too much focused on the upcoming satisfaction and momentary pleasure that we'll experience, and so we're not aware. But once confronted with that sin, coming to Jesus in repentance, his blood washes us clean of that offense so that Satan cannot stand before God and accuse us of being a sinner. So that Satan cannot stand before God and accuse us of not being worthy to enter into his eternal kingdom. Because as he makes his accusations, God turns a deaf ear to Satan because he sees that blood of Christ in which we are clothed, knows that that debt has been paid, and so he welcomes us into that kingdom for all eternity. No matter where we may worship, and no matter how we may worship, as long as we gather with hearts filled with reverence, awe, respect, and joy, we can truly say, how glorious is this place. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Please join me as we confess our faith in the words of the Son, A.C. Creed. Close your hands and your eyes. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in the world to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom shall have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated. Let us pray in the name of Jesus to our Heavenly Father for the church, the world, and one another. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Lord God, we humbly pray that you would discipline the church you love, set in a narrow way of peace, holiness, graciousness, and truth. Make it a trustworthy open gate to your kingdom, so that many may enter to offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving for the salvation you have granted them in Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
Touch with your beauty the goodness, the hearts of everyone in this congregation. Make our words gracious and our deeds lovely. Make of us a kingdom of priests, holy in your sight, and family of servants, faithfully doing your will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bestow your richest blessings upon missionaries of the gospel, so that many may come through the faith of Jesus through their testimony. Bless also, we pray, our sister synods and congregations and our national church body. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Join the suffering of your persecuted church to those of Christ. Give it a gracious world of testimony, truth, and forgiveness, so that its testimonies may repent and be saved. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bring to the fruition Israel's vision that all nations shall serve and worship you. Give the leaders the desire and the means to accomplish your will for peace, righteousness, and justice for all people, especially the poor and those devastated by human malice of natural disaster. Help all of us to be true friends and to be good neighbors to one another. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
The school year has begun, to the dread of students and delight of parents. Bless and guide them as the school year begins. Give the joy of learning and diligence in study. Strengthen and the desire of all teachers and aides. Help them to convey their love of their subject matter. Make them gentle disciplinarians, inspiring mentors, and worthy examples of their students. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless and protect the good men and women who risk their lives in defense of life, liberty, and safety, and justice. Shelter their families from fear, long them from home and safety. Heal their wounds to body and spirit, and use their service as building blocks for a happier and safer world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant the healing hope and strength to everyone who is sick or injured, abused or lonely, grieving or estranged, or who in any other way is wounded in body, soul, or mind. In their suffering, assure them your loving presence and give them all they need to enter into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Most holy, gracious Father, receive into your kingdom our beloved dead. Keep us faithful and true, holy and steadfast, as we walk the narrow way established by your dear Son. Give us joy along the way and help us to encourage and help one another along it. Bring us safely into the kingdom of light, life, and love, which you have vouchsafed to all whom you redeem by the suffering of Christ. And then let us see your face to face, the experience, the unspeakable joy of abiding in your love forever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In the power and Holy Spirit, we entrust our prayers and petitions into your hands, gracious Father, for the sake of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The offering.
Time for the offering today. The ushers are Gus and Connie Singleton. Worship assistant, Harvey Baker. You just heard Harvey lead us in the prayers of intercession. Connie Singleton was a reader. Sally Baker is a communion assistant. Gus and Connie Singleton are the ushers bringing forth the offering plates we receive as we are able to give to Jesus Christ. The elements are being prepared for Holy Communion. The elements of the body of Christ have been blessed and have been in the tabernacle, not been taken out of the tabernacle, and will be given to the people today. The remainder will be blessed to place in the tabernacle as Christ is always here with us today. He saved us from our sins. He died on the cross. We worship him. We know that he's with us. We are in worship here, and we receive his body and blood. We receive him in mind and spirit, in wholeness. We become one with him as he wanted to become one with us. He's madly in love with us, as God is madly in love with us, and wants more than anything else for us to love him back. Love God with all of our hearts and love our neighbors as ourselves. The ushers are coming forward. We invite you to come on September the 4th to the blessing of the pets at the drive-in service. It'll be our last drive-in service. After that, we'll have Sunday school starting again with Rally Day here. Today we have flowers given in memory of those who worked in the kitchen crew and who work in the kitchen crew now. The flowers today are given to the glory of God, and also in memory and in honor of those worshiping the kitchen crew. You can see the flowers on the altar, and they're also given at the drive-in service, which is at the Melody Cruise Inn every 8 o'clock every Sunday morning, rain or shine.
Gave thanks and gave it to all,
for all to drink, saying, this cup is new covenant in my blood shed to you for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ is dying. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering therefore his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to the Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these, your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we, and all who share in the body and blood of Christ, may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Christ has remained in the tabernacle all week for the love of us, and we worship him now for the love of Christ. We accept him as the redemption of all our sins, died for us on the cross to save us from sins. Now he gives us his body and blood to be with us forever and ever. always present with us here in the sanctuary and now within our bodies. We receive his body, his soul, his blood. We receive redemption. We receive forgiveness of sins. We receive the true body and true blood of Jesus Christ. As members of the church, you can see on their faces the joy that they have from the good news that God loves us unconditionally. He loves us madly. Jesus loves us, gives us his favor, and all we have to do is accept his gift of grace. Again by Isaac Watts, another hymn written by Isaac Watts in 1719. This hymn is famous because it was based on Psalm 90. Perhaps his most bracing hymn was played on the radio on the BBC as soon as World War II was declared. When World War II was declared, English played this, "Our God in Help, Our God, O God, Our Help in Ages Past." And then Winston Churchill died. Winston Churchill had this hymn sung at his funeral. Our God, our oh God, our help in ages past, written by Isaac Watts.
Yeah.
Crossing St. John's on YouTube. Tune in anytime for our Sunday broadcast. This is the 10:30 service, 21st of August. It's the 14th Sunday after Pentecost. We're happy to bring you this service. We offer a Christian school program for ages 3 and 4, nursery and pre-K. For information, call the school office, 325-4311. That's 325-4311. You see in front of you the resurrected body of Jesus Christ. He died on the cross to save us from our sins, resurrected from the dead. He's prophet, priest, and king. He sees prophet by the prophetic type of outfit he has on. He's priest because of priestly garments. And he's king because of the crown on his head. He's prophet, priest, and king. He's with us forever. He is with us here. He is present in the tabernacle. We're never away from him. But we feel more with him as he has done this for us because he loves us. He wants us to feel close to him. He wants us to have eternal life with him as we will see his face glorious when we die. We will see the face of God. No ear can hear, no eyes can see the wonderful things he has placed for us. Tune in anytime. Join us for our worship service this Lord's Day. Come Wednesday night. We have Wednesday night communion service. We have 8 o'clock service. And through the Labor Day, the 4th of September, the blessing of the pets. And this is the Melody Cruise and Drive. If you need to pray for us and support our YouTube ministry, God bless you this week and forevermore.